A Nexus event. My cats. Sitting out on my deck with the fire table going at night, either reading a book or visiting with someone.
Going out for dinner on a Friday night with Judy.
Playing video games?
Coffee. Morning coffee, yeah.
When Dave is home and we can hang out and just be on my front porch.
My dad has an espresso maker, so anytime I make the milk, if I get it close to the texture it should be at like a real coffee shop, I'm so happy.
Oh, the first coffee in the morning when the kids are gone, not when they're around. That.
Ouch.
Not that I like them around, but that, well, that sounds bad. Okay.
Having a glass of wine.
Mountain biking.
Nachos with Aaron once a week on our deck after the kids are in bed.
Playing? Just having, morning coffee in the sunshine.
Mm-hmm. I love showering. Showering is amazing.
Watching my kid happy, playing. Yeah.
Anticipation of being with friends and family.
Being with my grandson.
Getting in my bed after a long day.
Biking to school.
Having a glass of wine.
Reading.
The more I know, the less I understand all the things I thought I'd figure out. Well, forgiveness week three, my friends, and of course, last week we took a deep dive into the nature of sin, but to get to the forgiveness part, we have to see sin, I think, as more than just the HPTFTU. We need to understand sin and its capacity. I like to think of it as sin as an animating energy. You see, sin to me isn't a static event. It's a generator, you could say, of a certain kind of negative energy that's not only destructive in the moment, but carries with it the possibility of ongoing and further destruction. Sin, you could say, I suppose, is kind of like lightning. Now, according to National Geographic, a single bolt of lightning can travel over 5 miles and raise the temperature of the air by as much as 27,000 degrees Celsius, which is apparently 5 times hotter than the surface of the sun, though how anyone knows that, I'm not sure. But not only that, a bolt of lightning contains 1 million electrical volts. I mean, lightning is no doubt a dazzling display of nature's raw power, and from a distance, it's absolutely breathtaking. One of the things I love so much about a place like the Southwest is because it's such open terrain, you can see for miles, and being able to see storms form and sort of do their thing in the distance, it's just enough to take your breath away. And so to gaze upon a storm in the distance, it's really quite spectacular, but up close, it contains many great dangers. Of course, its raw power can certainly destroy or harm anything it directly touches, but I think what makes lightning all the more dangerous is that it can oftentimes simply act as a generator, as a catalyst, you could say, for even further destruction. You see, a single bolt of lightning can obliterate a tree without any trouble at all, but that same bolt can also become the single spark of energy that's needed to destroy on a much wider scale. I mean, consider some of the most remarkable instances in history where a lightning strike was just the beginning of a lot of trouble. You know, the interesting thing is I've had a peek into my fair share of church storage facilities or closets, and they tend to house plenty of oddities, usually old props and whatnot, but I have yet to find a set of explosives in a church closet, thank goodness, but apparently, centuries ago, it was thought that churches would actually make an ideal place to store gunpowder. And the Church of Saint Nazaire in Brescia, Italy, was one of those churches. It was home to almost 100 tons of gunpowder. And when it was struck by lightning in 1769, the initial strike didn't actually create that much damage. All it happened to do was start a little small fire. But when that small fire found the gunpowder, The explosion was devastating. Nearly a sixth of the entire city was completely leveled, and 3,000 people lost their lives. Or consider this wild story. It's Christmas Eve, 1971, just before noon, and 86 passengers along with six crew members board Lanza Flight 508, taking passengers from Lima to Pucallpa, Peru. And the flight would encounter some inclement weather, but they were under the pressure of the holiday flight schedule, and so the captain and crew decide to push through this storm system, and they end up being struck by lightning. Now, according to AeroHub today, although a lightning strike can be a quite unpleasant experience for aircraft crew and passengers, in most cases, they say it doesn't cause much physical damage to the plane, nor does it compromise its safety. But this incident wasn't most cases. You see, this lightning strike ended up igniting one of the plane's fuel tanks, and it caused an explosion within the airplane. All six crew members and 85 passengers again lost their lives. Everyone except one. Julianne Kopke, she was still in high school at the time. She was blasted from the plane in this explosion, still strapped to her seat, and she plummeted almost 10,000 feet and fell deep into the Amazon jungle and somehow lived. She was concussed, had a broken collarbone, she had an eye injury and a deep wound, a gash in her right arm, but she survived. And yet surviving the fall was only the first part of her harrowing tale. Alone and deep in the jungle, she wandered aimlessly for 10 whole days before she collapsed in what she thought was an abandoned hut, but local fishermen found her and canoed her out of the jungle to safety. Or consider this, one of the most common results of lightning strikes are, of course, wildfires, which we're seeing more and more of these days. In fact, in Canada, it is estimated that 45% of all wildfires are caused by lightning. And because those events occur oftentimes in remote locations, 81% of the total area of wilderness lost to forest fires is a direct result of lightning. In the U.S., the numbers are similar. It's 44% in 71. And so, of course, beside that, you have human stupidity, leaving campfires unattended, but lightning ranks right beside it as the major cause of damage to wilderness due to fires. In fact, during the summer of 1988, under drought and storm conditions, lightning was the cause of 42 of 51 fires that ended up setting Yellowstone National Park on fire. In fact, by the end of the fire season, 40% of the park, over 750,000 acres of wildland, had been lost, largely due to lightning. And so I think to get deeper under the concept of sin and how forgiveness relates to that, we have to understand sin as kind of like a lightning event. It's an animating energy that can cause far more damage than just the initial strike or wound would seem to warrant. The sins that we inflict upon other people or the sins we experience at the hand of others, they have the potential to smolder and then burst into flames. And you know, Jesus hints at this in several ways throughout the Gospels. And in one particular story, he's having an exchange with his disciple Peter. And Jesus is asked to answer a question about forgiveness. It plays out this way. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times?" And Jesus answered, "I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times." Now, notice what is happening here, right? Peter is playing the numbers game. He's like a bookkeeper, you could say here. He's trying to get as specific and practical about how forgiveness can be achieved. And what is the precise number is his question to Jesus. How many times should forgiveness be? Once? Twice? I mean, surely seven is tops, right? I mean, surely that's the limit, because beyond that, are you at that point not just enabling poor and harmful behavior? Are you not setting yourself up to be the victim? And Jesus' response is curious to me because he gives a specific number back to Peter. The answer is 77 times. Of course, the number is not just random, though, and it starts to, when we understand what Jesus is doing here, it starts to unpack for us, I think, the nature of sin and forgiveness. Because what Jesus is actually doing is referring to a story that comes to us very early in Scripture. And the earliest parts of Genesis, of course, provide us with a certain theological anthropology, you could say. It gives us a peek, the earliest parts of Genesis, at the human condition. It does so through poetry and story and myth. And much of what it means to be human can really be found in just a few short chapters in the beginning of Genesis. It explains to us the nature of HPTFTU. And of course, most folk are familiar with the Adam and Eve story, a talking serpent eating from a tree, of course. But after Adam and Eve have largely exited the scene, the stage, you could say, we're given another archetypal story of what it means to be human by way of this character named Lamech. Here's how the story begins. Lamech said to his wives, Ada and Zillah, listen to me. Wives of Lamech, hear my words. I have killed a man for wounding me, a young man for injuring me. If Cain is avenged 7 times, then Lamech 77 times. Our desire for revenge. And notice here the progression that sin takes, like a lightning strike that sort of becomes bigger than the initial wound. Lamech has been wounded. He's been sinned against. He is a victim in early human history, you could say. And as is still the case today, right, you don't do exactly well in life if people think they can hurt you and get away with it. And so Lamech's been struck by these wounds, these injuries, but it doesn't end there. The wound festers and smolders. And eventually it turns into this wildfire of revenge. Payback's coming 77-fold. Thus, we are introduced to the early human pattern of sin played out in its totality. Sin is rarely an isolated event, but a cycle. Wound, resentment, revenge, repeat. Wound, resentment, revenge, repeat. And this is the cycle most of us spend a lot of our lives playing in. And there's no exit plan for it, just a vicious cycle that spins madly on, and its consequences can be brutal, both for others and for ourselves. This, you could say, is the propensity and cycle of the way of death. It's like a single lightning strike that torches but one tree, but then becomes inflamed. And this inferno is enough to torch thousands of kilometers of forest. What exactly is the way out? I mean, it reminds me of that Coldplay song, right? Where Chris Martin, I guess, says, no, I don't want a battle from beginning to end. I don't want a cycle of recycled revenge. I don't want to follow death and all of his friends. And of course, this pattern or cycle is so easy to spot on the grandest of scales, right? I mean, the genesis of virtually every war or act of violence started this way. But it becomes less easy to point out in our own personal lives, but it's always there, always. Wounds from friends, partners, churches, parents, coworkers, neighbors. I mean, the list could go on and on. But once we have become struck by a wound, we have the propensity to wallow in it, to allow it to fester, you could say, ruminating on it as the initial spark of damage to us, whatever that wound is. It's all it takes, you could say, within our hearts is like a strong wind or drought conditions before it becomes consuming. And as humans, we can become obsessed with those who have hurt or wounded us. You ever have those times, right, where if you think of your mind as like a piece of real estate, like these people who have hurt us are occupying prime real estate in our minds, and they just spin in there over and over, and we lose sleep over these people, rehearsing maybe only in our minds the things that we wish we could say or speak or do to them. And of course, all of us are great at wearing the polite overtures, you could say, of common decency in public. Of course, we keep the smile on our face, but inside we can be festering with resentment, waiting for just the subtlest of opportunities to speak ill of these people, to somehow get a little bit back at them. But Jesus enters the picture and offers an escape route, an exit plan, you could say, a path to walk that takes us beyond the path of Lamech, which is wound, resentment, revenge, repeat. What Jesus offers us is a new path, the path of forgiveness. And by citing a specific number here, calling us to forgive 77 times, what Jesus is saying, I think, is that our desire for forgiveness must meet and match every impulse or wandering thought that we encounter that might spur us towards revenge. You see, forgiveness is not a single action, a one-time event. It's a path to follow, and the journey is long. To say forgiveness should be a sort of one and done kind of thing is kind of like saying you can walk the Bruce Trail, the entirety of it, in a day. No, that's impossible. And it's the same with forgiveness. It's a path. It's long. And when Lamech's desire for revenge or resentment grows inside of us, we extend forgiveness again. We keep walking that long path of forgiveness. It is, as Paul Young once said, thinking about forgiveness, you may have to declare forgiveness 100 times the first day and the second day, but the third day will be less than each day after until one day you realize that you've forgiven completely. There's another story of this in the Gospels that illustrates this idea well. Sin is an animating energy. What starts often as a single wound can mushroom into something much larger. And it's found, I think, in one of the most popular stories of Jesus, his act of showing mercy to a woman that's been caught in the act of adultery. The details are scant, but the story illustrates for us sort of two competing visions of the world, the way of karma or the way of grace, the way of revenge or the way of forgiveness, the path of Lamech or the path of Jesus. And the story unfolds for us in John chapter 8 when Jesus is confronted by an angry mob. They have caught a woman under the sheets, so to speak, with a man who is not only not her husband, but presumably is married to another woman as well. And the barbarity of this scene can actually obscure some of the dynamics at play here, but the brutality of the scene also can't be ignored because it's actually part of the point. You see, according to Hebrew law back in the day, if you had an affair, you had to die. Adultery was considered a capital offense. And of course, I know to our ears today, that's like, oh my goodness, that's rather harsh. Of course it was. And this punishment for this sin, this wound, seems more than a little over the top to our ears. But if we can get past that for a moment, it reinforces the point about sin becoming an animating energy. You see, yes, we have to start with recognizing what this man and woman have done was a sin. It definitely caused harm. Without mention in this story are, of course, two other adults who are left to deal with the chaos and wounds of being cheated on. And though they're not mentioned in the story, we can't forget that the story starts there with a sin, a wound, a wrong, a very real wound. Lightning has struck, and some adult lives have been hurt and harmed by this action. But what seems to be occurring here is this lightning strike has started a wildfire. Now, of course, a few things seem to have escaped the minds of this brute force mob. And this is where things get interesting. You see, to start, the Hebrew law is actually very specific about one thing when it comes to adultery and very vague about another thing. Here is what they're specific about. If a man commits adultery with another man's wife, with the wife of his neighbor, both the adulterer and the adulteress are to be put to death. If a man is found sleeping with another man's wife, both the man who slept with her and the woman must die. Again, over the top, barbaric, yes, but the law is very specific. Both parties are supposed to die, and yet mysteriously, the man somehow remains missing from the scene. What the law is vague about, though, however, is exactly how the guilty parties are supposed to die. And this is where the original sin of adultery has morphed here from a thunderbolt into this towering inferno. The mob decides on stoning. And I confess, I'm no expert on better or worse ways to die, but I'm inclined to think that being pelted with stones until your head is mush, well, That seems particularly grotesque to me. Now things are getting even more big, more spiteful, more grotesque. This original sin is growing way out of proportion. And the mob, of course, is following the path of Lamech. Sins, debts, they need to be paid back 77 times the rate of the original offense. Everything here in this scene is following the same old pattern, the same old story. All that is needed for this thing to go off into an explosion is for someone to throw the first stone. And it's here that Jesus is asked to weigh in with commentary. And then comes those penetrating words of his. Let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her. The initial wound that this woman and man inflicted on others has become and morphed into this mob mentality wildfire. Payment, the mob believes, is needed now, except Jesus interrupts here. It's as if Jesus is saying, you know what, if we're going to play the game of collecting debts, well, then let's go to the ledger, let's go to the bookkeeping and see what everybody here owes. Because sure, if you're debt-free, go ahead and collect your bloodthirsty payment. But do recall how the game of bookkeeping really goes. Today, you might be throwing stones at someone. Tomorrow, you might find the rocks are coming for you. And with that, the mob evaporates and disappears, and we're left with just these two, Jesus and this woman. This is a pivotal moment in the scene. He's the only one left standing of the crowd, the only one who didn't depart when the question of sins hung in the air. And he stands beside her, the only person that could remain in a setting where no sin was permitted. And there they stand together, sinner and sinless. Now what? Because the reality is the initial offense, the initial lightning strike, it created real wounds. For the two unlucky adults on the other side of affair, they're the victims of HPT-FTU. Surely something needs to be done. Is there no justice? No penalty? It seems not. Jesus tells her there's no condemnation. She's forgiven. She's free of that system, the system where every time a wrong is done, it must be met with equal or greater measure. She's now free of that system and free to walk the Jesus path. And yeah, I find this story once again illustrates the animating energy of sin, like a lightning strike that starts a wildfire, or Lamech's demand that he have revenge to the 77th degree. Sin has this animating energy to it. It's like a conductor that when you plug into it, it merely makes us conduits of this negative energy that's been introduced in the world. And by plugging in, we simply spread it. In KW, we live just an hour west of Toronto, right? And for me, I remember trips into Toronto when I was a kid were just always so memorable. Most of the journeys into the big city as a child for me, they involved visiting the Sky Dome, of course, home of the Toronto Blue Jays. And of course, these days, excursions to Toronto for me involve more than just baseball games. And Toronto's a great city. It's host to world-class museums, sport teams, concert venues, exhibits, restaurants, restaurant shopping. I mean, it's always a great time to head there for a day or even the weekend. And of course, we all know Toronto's skyline is dominated by its famous concrete pillar, the CN Tower. Finished in 1976, it boasts a total height of 1,815.3 feet, giving it the title of the world's largest freestanding structure. And that designation lasted for 35 years, only to be surpassed by the Burj Khalifa Tower in the United Arab Emirates in 2005. And for some reason, it seems humans have gotten crazy about building tall towers over the past 20 years, because the CN Tower, once it lost its spot, it's now sitting at number 9 in the list of tallest freestanding structures in the world. Rounding out is the top 10 is, of course, World Trade Center, One World Trade Center in New York. So it's fallen a few places, but for those of us who go to Toronto on occasion, it remains Toronto's ubiquitous monument, right? This concrete spiral feels almost omnipresent, right, when you're walking around the city. And naturally, of course, given its height, the tower also functions as something of a lightning magnet. Given the hazards, of course, of the lightning phenomenon, the engineers of the tower knew precautions would have to take place. According to their website, the CN Tower is well prepared for a lightning strike, which is good to know. They have a series of copper strips that run the length of the tower, and copper is, of course, very conductive. It allows the electrons of lightning to move easily through it, and it feeds into this massive grounding system of rods that are buried below the ground level. And so when lightning does strike the tower, the electrical discharge runs the wires, it diffuses into the ground. And don't worry, this system seems to have been put to the test a number of times in the past decades. According to their website, on average, the CN Tower is struck by lightning 75 times per year. Now, lightning rods have been in existence, apparently, for about 250 years. And the concept of the idea, of course, came from Benjamin Franklin and his famous kite experiment. Now, only his son William actually witnessed this experiment, so it's a bit of a legend, I suppose you could say. But as legend has it, Franklin attached a little metal key to a kite, and then he tied the kite to an insulating silk sort of ribbon mitten that he put over the knuckles of his hand, as if that's going to help. But who knows, he survived to tell the tale. And how he walked away from this experiment unscathed is beyond me. But apparently this experiment proved that lightning was a form of electricity and that its energy could be directed. And with that was the birth of the lightning rod. Today, Franklin's lightning rods are known by many names: air terminals, finials, lightning conductors, or strike termination devices among them. The rods, typically a half inch in diameter, are connected to a metal cable hidden within the building or structure. The cables make their way down to earth where they are anchored. Grounded, the lightning rod dissipates the lightning strike's energy. Incredibly simple in its design. I mean, lightning rods are an engineering marvel that protect people and structures from the explosive power of lightning itself. And their solution is simple: to direct energy of lightning to the ground and allow it to dissipate there. And I would say this: I think forgiveness works in much the same way. Forgiveness is to send and wounds and harm what a lightning rod is to lightning. Forgiveness is the process of drawing the negative energy of sin inside ourselves and allowing it to dissipate there, rather than passing its energy on, either back to the perpetrator or other innocent parties around us. In the early 1960s, Jerome Caddell hosted an interracial retreat at his monastery in Arkansas. And one of the participants in that retreat was a young black man who had recently graduated from college, and he was helping out with the civil rights movement in the early 1960s. And he was doing that by helping to extend and sign people up for voter registration in Arkansas. And during this retreat, the man told those there of the stories of violence he had faced in his work. He told stories about how he had been spitten on, beaten up, attacked with clubs and chains. I mean, this guy had bruised and bled for the cause of civil rights. At one point during the retreat, though, Jerome recalls asking the man, saying to him, "Wait a second, you're a pretty big guy. Did you ever fight back?" This was the young man's response: "Yes, at first I did fight back. I made some of them sorry that they had attacked me. But then I realized that by fighting back, I wasn't getting anywhere. The hatred coming at me in those fists and clubs was bouncing right off me back into the air, and it could just continue to spread like electricity. And so I decided not to fight back. I would let my body absorb that hatred so that some of it would die in my body and not bounce back into the world. I now see that my job in the midst of evil is to make my body a grave for hate." What does it mean to forgive others, to make our bodies, our minds, our spirits a grave for hate? You know, forgiveness is the act of ensuring a lightning strike wound doesn't turn into a wildfire. It's to ensure that wounds inflicted upon us end with us. You know, it's interesting. Many of us know Herb Spencer, a dear old friend of ours at Nexus, and he's been emailing the past few weeks on the series of forgiveness. And I love the way he defined forgiveness to me in an email. He simply said this: forgiveness is not accepting a hurt as okay, nor is it giving up the desire for truth and reconciliation. Forgiveness is giving up the desire for retaliation or revenge, which is precisely it. It's allowing ourselves to let go of those desires, those Lamech desires within us. And Fred Luskin, a director of the Stanford University Forgiveness Projects and author of the book Forgive for Good, A Proven Prescription for Health and Happiness, says this of forgiveness: psychologists generally define forgiveness as a conscious, deliberate decision to release feelings of resentment or vengeance toward a person or group who has harmed you, regardless of whether they actually deserve your forgiveness. And I think this is so important to define, to get into the nitty-gritty of what it means to forgive, to understand both what forgiveness is and what it is not. You see, forgiveness is not about excusing away actions that have hurt or harmed us. Forgiveness is not about receiving apologies and then saying back sort of tritely, "I forgive you." It's not about restoring a relationship and treating the offending party as if nothing ever happened. No. Forgiveness is about ensuring our minds, our bodies, our spirits become a grave for hate. It's about ensuring that we don't allow the wounds and sorrows and sufferings of life to fester inside of us into a toxic, dysfunctional inferno of resentment and spite. It's about internalizing the very real wrongs committed against us and refusing to allow ourselves to travel the path of Lamech. As William Paul Young says, forgiveness is not about forgetting. It's about letting go of another person's throat. Next week, friends, I want to get into how we can practice that specifically. But for this morning, I want to end there. But how I thought I would end this morning as we prepare for next week to get even further into the details of forgiveness, I thought it might be interesting for us to start with an imagination exercise recommended by Archbishop Desmond Tutu. And his story of having to forgive his father is a remarkable one. Look it up on the internet. It's quite powerful. But he recommends the process of forgiveness this way. He says, imagine you're standing in front of a large cabinet and it has many drawers. And each of those drawers, inside each of those drawers is a sin, a wrong, a hurt or wound you haven't dealt with yet in life. Because he says it's impossible to think about forgiving everything done to us as a whole in this one sort of giant scoop, right? But he does say we can work with these drawers individually. And so he suggests that a good start to the practice of forgiveness is to just imagine this large cabinet in front of us, many drawers, each representing one particular wrong or hurt against us, and then to select just one drawer. He recommends this: take it out, examine its contents, feel what is inside of it, feel it all. And that's where I want to leave us this week, that maybe we would take the time to think about this sort of imagination exercise, and this week choose one drawer, one wrong, one harm that has been visited against us. Next week, I want to talk about what to do with those drawers, but for now, for this week, maybe just allow ourselves to examine that. Allow ourselves to feel all of it fully. Before you is a cabinet of many drawers, each one representing a wrong that was done to you. Which one do we want to deal with first? We'll get at that for next Sunday, our season finale. Thanks for joining us, Nexus, this morning. I appreciate, as always, you giving us your time and attention and your energy. One more week to go before a bit of a summer break, and I'm excited about that. So until then, go in peace. Thank you.
lightning crashes on the mother cries. Hopeless until it falls to the floor. Sets in before the doctor can even close the door. Lightning crashes, an old mother dies. Her intentions fall. Rolling thunder, chasing the wind, forces pain.